A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankara IAS Academy for the date 25th May 2021. These are the list of news articles taken for today's discussion. They have been provided along with the page numbers of these articles in different editions of Hindi newspaper. So now let us start our news analysis with this first snippet news article from the business page. This news article talks about the AT1 bonds. See, the news is that Securities Appellate Tribunal has stayed a SEBI order. This order slapped a penalty of 25 crore rupees on Yes Bank. And this order has been stayed by Securities Appellate Tribunal. See, as you know, the Yes Bank crisis is making a buzz for a year now. And in that context, AT1 bonds have also become prominent. So in this discussion, let us understand the issue in detail. And we'll also see what are these AT1 bonds and its relevance to the Yes Bank issue. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us start with the Yes Bank issue. As you know, Yes Bank was the fifth largest private bank. And between 2014 and 2019, Yes Bank went on a lending spree. That is, it lent more. And in 2017, under the asset quality review initiated by RBI, it checked the credits that are being given out by the banks. This review also scrutinized the bank's lending practices. And in that only, the skeletons in Yes Bank's closet were revealed. That is, the secrets for the Yes Bank was revealed. And the issue came into RBI radar when the non-performing asset in the bank increased close to 8% in May 2020. Along with this, the credit deposit ratio even crossed 100% when the customers started sensing something went wrong with the bank and they started withdrawing rampantly. So this is what happened with the Yes Bank. Now let us understand these issues one by one in detail. First, as you know, a non-performing asset is where a loan that is lent by the bank doesn't earn any interest or even repayment also doesn't happen. And in this regard, RBI has fixed criteria as to when to classify an asset as NPA, that is non-performing asset. As per these criteria, if a loan that does not earn interest or no installment for more than 90 days, then it is classified as an NPA. Now, what is this credit deposit ratio? See, as you know, we deposit money in a bank. Now, banks take that money and they lend it to those who are in need of loans. Now, the interest from these loans are the bank's earnings. But note that the bank doesn't lend all the money which it gets from depositors. It retains some of the deposits for those who withdraw. So the credit deposit ratio is generally in the range of 70% for a healthy bank. That is, roughly 70% of the deposits are lent and 30% retained to give it to the withdrawers. But for Yes Bank, the issue was this credit deposit ratio crossed 100%, meaning that it lent more than what it received. In other words, we can also say that Yes Bank lent everything which it received as deposits. And in addition to this, it also borrowed some more to meet the loan demands. Here, the deposits by customers depleted, but the lending spree of Yes Bank did not come down. So ultimately, it had two impacts. First is that the bank may have to borrow from outside to lend. And secondly, it may not be able to meet the demands of the withdrawers. See, normally, a successful operation of a bank depends on its asset-liability match. When a bank indulges in outside borrowing, it is an indication that the asset liability match is not under control. Here you should remember that an asset for a bank is the loan which it has lent and liability is the deposits that we make in the bank. Loan is an asset because we will repay the loans and it will become an asset of the bank. And deposits are a liability because we may withdraw the deposits anytime and the bank has to pay us back. Now, besides this, a dubious lending practice was also adopted by Yes Bank, which led to piling up of NPAs. That is, it lent to those companies which did not have a good repayment record. And we cannot expect a non-payer to return a debt. So, the NPAs piled up with the Yes Bank. Now, all this led to low profitability of the bank. And last year, when the Yes Bank issue got worse, RBI interfered and it put caps on the lending and withdrawal in the bank as a temporary measure. RBI also brought about enormous changes in the banking governance structure. As a part of this, State Bank of India infused about 49% as capital. That is, SBI bought 49% of shares at 10,000 crores. And besides this, various lending instruments were also scrutinized. And when that was done, 81 bonds came to light. And in this regard, SEBI earlier levied penalty on the Yes Bank. So what are these 81 bonds? AT1 bonds is the short form for additional tier 1 bonds. And these are not like conventional bonds. See, if you take the conventional bonds, we buy them, we get paid on maturity along with interest. This is a simple procedure. And here, the maturity period is predefined in the bond conditions. As you know, maturity is the validity of the bond. And at the end of such maturity, the bond buyer gets paid along with the interests. But this AT1 bond is not like that. These AT1 bonds are attractive option for buyers. So what makes it attractive? It is the high interest rates that are offered by AT1 bonds. But this even comes with a risk. And the risk is that these AT1 bonds are perpetual bonds. So what are these perpetual bonds? The maturity of these bonds is not defined in the bond conditions. And that is why they are perpetual bonds. That is, when the bond matures is not defined in the bond. So this makes AT1 bonds as a very risky instrument. This is because the company that sold the bond may never issue maturity. In other words, it may never redeem it. In that case, the bond buyer or the investor will be at complete loss. So it is one of the most risky financial instruments in the market. If you see, usually mutual funds invest in these AT1 instruments. And in the S Bank case also, a lot of mutual funds had invested in the AT1 bonds. And most of them were written off. That is, they were not paid back. We already saw that the validity in AT1 bonds may never be issued, and that is what happened here also. So this prompted many investors, that is the AT1 bond buyers from the Yes Bank, to file cases. And regarding this only, today's news article has appeared. So what is the news? See, earlier, RBI extinguished the rights on the AT1 bonds associated with the Yes Bank. So consequently, SEBI received many complaints from the AT1 investors or buyers. And here, the buyers accused the Yes Bank for spuriously or falsely selling the bonds as a safe investment option. So in order to safeguard the interest of the investors, which is one of the functions of SEBI, SEBI slapped a penalty on Yes Bank. And regarding this, it seems that Yes Bank has approached the Securities Appellate Tribunal. And regarding this only, the order has came now. And in this order, Securities Appellate Tribunal has stayed the order of SEBI regarding penalty for further consideration. So this is the news as of today. Now let us wait and see what is the next step taken by the Appellate Tribunal and how it resolves the issue of Yes Bank and also of the AT1 bond buyers. These are some of the matters that you should know about the Yes Bank issue and AT1 bonds. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article. It talks about the protests that are happening in the Union Territory of Lakshadweep. Now, these protests are happening for last few days, and it is happening due to a large number of administrative reforms that have taken place in the Union Territory recently. These administrative reforms were announced by the island's administrator, Mr. Praful Patel. See, as you know, a Union Territory is administered by the president through an administrator who is appointed by the president. And this administrator is given certain designations, like the administrator is given the designation of Lieutenant Governor in case of Delhi and Puducherry. And in case of Lakshadweep, the administrator is called as administrator only. So these reforms have been announced by the island's administrator, Praful Patel. Now, currently, the protests for these reforms have got widespread support, and the protests are intensifying under the Save Lakshadweep campaign. So in this context, let us first discuss about the Lakshadweep Islands, its history, and the ongoing developments. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, as you know, Lakshadweep Islands group lies close to the Malabar coast of Kerala in the Arabian Sea. This group of islands is composed of small coral islands, and earlier they were all known as Lakshadweep, Minicoy, and Amindiv. But in 1973 only, these were renamed as Lakshadweep. Now in Malayalam and Sanskrit, Lakshadweep means 100,000 islands. And note that Lakshadweep is India's smallest union territory. It is an archipelago which consists of 36 islands with an area of 32 square kilometers. And it is also a unidistrict union territory. That is, it has only one district. And this union territory is composed of 12 atolls, 3 reefs, 5 submerged banks, and 10 inhabited islands. Now, the capital of this union territory is Kavaratti, which is also the principal town of Lakshadweep. So, what about the history of Lakshadweep Islands? See, the local traditions in these islands attribute to the period of Cheraman Perumal, who was the last king of Kerala. At that period, first settlements on these islands began. It is believed that the king converted to Islam on the instructions of some Arab merchants and he went for Mecca. Now, for searching the king, several search parties went after him and they started small settlements in the islands of Amini, Kavaretti, Androt and Kalpeni. And later, when Portuguese arrived in India, they made Lakshadweep as important place for seafarers. Most importantly, at that time, this finely spun coir was much needed for these ships. So the Portuguese started looting the island vessels and it is said that they even forcibly landed at the Amini Island to procure coir sometime in the early 16th century. But the people killed all these invaders by poisoning and thereby they also ended the Portuguese invasion in their islands. But after this, the entire island population converted to Islam. But even then, the sovereignty of the islands remained in the hands of a Hindu Raja of Chirakkal in Kerala for some years. Now, from the hands of the Chirakkal Raja, the administration of the island was passed on to the Muslim House of Arakkal of Kannanore. And this happened around the middle of 16th century. And later, some of the islands even came under the reign of Tipu Sultan. But the island was annexed to the British East India Company after the Battle of Seringapatam or the Srirangapatnam in the year 1799. And from then, it was administered by the British East India Company from Mangalore. So after independence, this group of islands was made into a union territory in the year 1956. And later it was given the name of Lakshadweep in 1973. So now what is the recent issue? See, the heart of the problem of these issues is the draft Lakshadweep Development Authority Regulation of 2021. Now, this regulation gives the administrator certain powers for town planning or any developmental activity. And these powers include removal or relocation of islanders from their property also. So, this has created widespread protests. Along with this, there is also another controversy, which is over the Prevention of Antisocial Activities Act. It was introduced in the Union Territory in January 2021. Now, this act empowers the government to detain a person without any public disclosure for a period of up to 1 year. So, people are also not happy with this legislation. And the next controversy is regarding a draft Lakshadweep Animal Preservation Bill. This bill provides for a ban on the sale of beef. So, this bill is also facing criticism in the Union Territory. Then there is also another reform which is under question. It is the draft Lakshadweep Panchayat Regulation of 2021. As per this regulation, no person shall be a member of a Gram Panchayat or they cannot continue as a member of a Gram Panchayat if they have more than 2 children. So we can see that these legislations are affecting the lives of the people and their normal administration. And these issues gained prominence when a Kerala Rajya Sabha MP wrote a letter to the President of India and requested the president to urgently call back the Lakshadweep administrator. So let us see what happens next. And we can hope that the island's administration will consider people's woes while enacting the laws from now on. So these are some of the points that you need to know about the recent issues that are ongoing in the Lakshadweep group of islands. We will know more about this in the coming days when we see more news articles. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this op-ed article, which talks about child sexual abuse. See, recently a teacher was suspended from a school in Chennai due to sexual misconduct. And this incident has again put the POCSO Act in spotlight. So on this backdrop only, this op-ed article has been written. And the author here talks mainly about the historical child sexual abuse and how the Indian laws are inefficient in dealing with it. So let us now discuss these aspects. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, as you know, the POCSO Act, that is the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act of 2012, was enacted to protect the children from offences of sexual assault, sexual harassment and pornography with due regard for safeguarding the interest and well-being of the children. And as per this act, child is any person who is below 18 years of age. And this act regards the best interest and welfare of the child as a matter of paramount importance at every stage. Now, this is to ensure the healthy physical development, emotional development, intellectual and social development of the child. And the act also defines different forms of sexual abuse, including penetrative and non-penetrative assault, as well as sexual harassment and pornography. And we have discussed salient features of this act on our May 8th Hindi News analysis. Aspirants can view that analysis for better understanding about this act. But today, our focus and this op-ed article is based on the inefficiency of the POCSO Act in dealing with the historical child sexual abuse cases. So first, what is this historical child sexual abuse? See, in simple terms, it refers to the incidents that are reported late. According to the author of the op-ed article, historical abuse is not just confined to the institutions, but it also includes intrafamilial abuse, that is the abuse that occurs within the family. And particularly in intrafamilial abuse, it is difficult for the child to report the offense or even the offender at the earliest point in time. It often takes time for the child to recognize the abuse and comprehend the gravity of what has happened. And it even takes more time for the child to become confident enough to report the offense or the abuse. But even when the child gathers such confidence required to report the offense, there are many hurdles in the reporting and prosecution of historical child sexual abuse cases. And the biggest one such hurdle is the principle of criminal law. See, according to the principle of criminal law, every act of crime must be reported at the earliest, and any delay in filing the complaint dilutes the efficacy of the prosecution's case. So, based on this principle, giving power to historical cases may seem like we are acting against the principle. In addition to this, we know that POCSO Act was enacted in 2012 only. But prior to its enactment, cases involving child sexual abuse were classified under lesser offense. For example, they were filed under Section 354 of Indian Penal Code. And this section is about the assault criminal force to woman with the intent to outrage her modesty. See here, the term outrage her modesty is very important because the law doesn't define it. And even Supreme Court referred that modesty is a feminine decency and is a virtue that woman possesses owing to their sex. So what does outraging modesty means? See, for example, let us assume that two children are playing and among them one is a girl child and they are playing Holi, and while playing, the male child rips the t-shirt of the female child. Now, this act becomes a crime only if the male child has intended to do it or only if the child knew that this act could outrage the modesty of the girl child. Otherwise, it is not considered a crime. So here the part intent is more important. So before POCSO Act, child sexual abuses were filed under Section 354 only, which dealt with outraging the modesty of a woman. Along with this, there was also another hurdle, which was that any reporting of an offense under Section 354 of the IPC more than 3 years after the date of incident is barred by the CRPC. This is prohibited under Section 468 of Code of Criminal Procedure, which sets a time limit for the reporting of offences. But since now POCSO Act has been enacted and this act overrides all the other acts where there is discrepancy, currently no such time limit is set by the POCSO Act. But the historical child sexual offence cases before 2012 could not be reported, and such a scenario renders reporting of such cases unlikely. And this also presented an insurmountable legal barrier against the registration of historical child sexual offences, which took place before 2012. Now, you may ask why such a time limit is included in CRPC. See, these time limitations were incorporated to avert delayed prosecution, but can understand that the circumstances around child sexual abuse cannot be and they must not be viewed in the same manner as any other criminal offence. So, delayed reporting and prosecution with regard to incidents of child sexual offences are vital for protecting our children, because we know that children do not report the sexual abuse immediately due to various factors. Like they may be experiencing threats from the perpetrator, or they may be fearing public humiliation, or they may even lack trustworthy confidant, or they may also experience accommodation syndrome. So, what is this accommodation syndrome, which is very common among the victims of child sexual abuse? See, accommodation syndrome is a situation where the child keeps the abuse a secret because of the fear that no one will believe the abuse. And this leads to accommodative behavior where the child pretends like nothing has happened. So because of these reasons only, the abused child will take time to understand the situation and then report it. There is also growing research and empirical evidence that point to the behavior which justify delayed reporting. So it is high time that, or it is necessary that we amend the current laws to favor reporting and prosecution of historical child sexual abuse cases. But our government is hesitating to do so. It is mainly because in delayed reporting, there is lack of evidence to advance prosecution. According to various studies, in delayed reporting, we have less than 5% chance of gathering direct physical evidence or medical evidence. So this makes it difficult to convict the perpetrator. Along with this, in India, we also lack procedures or procedural guidelines in dealing with the historical cases of child sexual abuse. So in this regard only, author has given a suggestion, which is that India should follow United Kingdom when it comes to historical cases of child sexual abuse. See, UK has issued detailed guidelines regarding historical child sexual abuses or historical abuses. And these guidelines are designed to set out the approach that has to be followed by the prosecutors while dealing with the child sexual abuse cases in general and also in dealing with the historical cases. So India can follow these guidelines from UK and frame its own guidelines to overcome the current inadequacies with respect to historical cases of child sexual abuse. So these are some of the points that you can take note from this OPID article. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this picture which depicts a beautiful halo that was witnessed in Bengaluru. See, there is something infinitely healing about the nature. And this first page picture reminds us about that. And this beautiful halo is a refreshing departure from the harrowing and haunting articles about the pandemic. And for those of us who have forgotten what nature looks like since we are in the lockdown, let us take a moment to understand this natural phenomenon from exam perspective. See, this halo was witnessed in Bengaluru, as I said earlier, and this bright rainbow ring around the sun was witnessed for a few minutes on Monday morning. This is a rare optical and atmospheric phenomenon. It is called as 22 degree circular halo. If you see, this halo also occurs around the moon. And if it happens around the moon, it is called as moon ring or winter halo. Previously, before the advent of meteorology, halos formed a part of weather lore because it was used to predict rains in a region. It was believed that if a halo occurs, then within 2 hours since the time of its appearance, it would rain. So in this regard, let us understand the science behind it. See, this phenomenon occurs when the sun's rays or moon's rays get deflected or when they get refracted through the hexagonal ice crystals which are present in the cirrus clouds. You may recollect cirrus clouds from geography NCERT reading. It is the most common form of clouds. They are thin clouds and they are high level clouds, typically found at heights greater than 20,000 feet, that is around 6,000 meters. These clouds contain millions of tiny crystals, and these crystals act as prisms when light passes through them. So they refract, split, and even reflect the light to give an impression of a circular rainbow ring. And when this is formed at 22 degrees from the sun, it is called as 22 degrees circular halo. So that is all you need to know about this natural phenomenon. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which mentions that IIT Delhi is going to set up an optics and photonics center. Now, through this center, they're planning to study the fundamental properties of light and using them in practical application. So in this discussion, let us see what do we mean by photonics and why it is important. See, photonics is the branch of science and technology that deals with the generation, control, and detection of particles of light, that is photons. So in other words, we can say that photonics is the science of light, or simply the study of photon is the photonics. Now, as you know, we can only see a very small part of electromagnetic spectrum, and this part is the visible region. But the invisible light waves are also part of our everyday life, and that is why it becomes important to study them and harness it. Now, this photonics involves cutting-edge uses of lasers, optics, fiber optics, and electro-optical devices in various and diverse fields of technology. Here, you should know about optoelectronics. It is an important field of photonics. In this, useful interaction between semiconducting materials and light is explored, and this is done for the origin, control, and detection of light. So some of important optoelectronic devices include photodiode, solar cell, and light emitting diodes, that is LEDs. So in this regard, you should know that photonics supports technologies that we use in our everyday life, like from smartphones to laptops, then internet to the lightning technology, medical diagnosis and treatment procedures like that. So it has applications in education, manufacturing industries, medicine, entertainment, agriculture, defense and security, exploring universe, in solving crimes, and also in art and culture, etc. And we are going to more focus on the applications of photonics because in prelims, technologies or applications of physics like this are more often asked. So let us see these applications one by one. First, it is used in aerospace technology because it has uses in LIDAR, that is the light detection and ranging, or in laser radar systems. And it is also used in laser altimeters, then in optical pattern recognition systems for navigation, etc. Then it also finds application in agriculture because it is used in satellite remote sensing to detect large-scale crop effects. It is used in scanning technology and infrared imaging to monitor food production and quality. It is also used in sensor systems for planting and irrigation. Then it also finds application in biomedicine, especially it is used as lasers for surgery, therapies, etc., like photodynamic therapy, and it is also used in LASIK procedures. That is the one which is related to eyes. Then it can also detect diseases at an early stage with non-invasive imaging techniques. Other than non-invasive imaging techniques, it also can be used for non-invasive treatments. For example, in surgery for brain tumors, cyber knife system is used, which works by delivering beams of high-dose radiation to the tumors with extreme accuracy. So this high beam of radiation only targets the tumor and it does not target the healthy cells. Other than this, a laser scalpel is also extremely useful in surgery. And nowadays, it is more often used by surgeons. Next, let us see its uses in engineering, microtechnology and nanotechnology. Here also, lasers are used in the manufacture of electrical devices, motors, engines, semiconductor chips, circuits, and computers. Then other than this, supermarket barcode scanners and credit card holograms also include photonics. Then most importantly, it also has a use of an enabling technology in alternate energy solutions or green solutions. See, the contribution of photonics is considered green if it generates or conserves energy, or even if it reduces pollution, or when it yields an environmentally sustainable outcome, or when it improves public health. So in this regard, some of the green photonics or green solutions include photovoltaic devices, which are used for solar electric panels, that is the solar photovoltaic panels. Then it also includes solar heating, solar thermal electricity, etc. Apart from this, it also finds application in solid state lighting, and this includes light emitting diodes, that is LEDs and OLEDs, which is nothing but organic LED technologies. Then it is also used in geographic information systems and global positioning. Then in information technology, it is most widely used. It is used for data storage, then ultra-fast data switching, especially transmission of data across fiber optic networks uses photonics. Then it is also used in infrared remote controls, TV flat panels, optical scanners, computer displays, etc. Then if we come to transportation, for example, if we take cars, the comfort and control provided by the infrared security systems in cars uses photonics, and then optical monitors for anti-lock brakes, then optical fiber dashboard displays, LED traffic signals, laser traffic radars, all of these are manifestation of photonics. Then next, it also has uses in security, where it is used in DNA scanning, laser forensics, retinal scanning, identification of dangerous substances, optical surveillance, etc. And in biotechnology, for example, if you take the infrared non-contact ear thermometers, which is more often used in this pandemic, is also a manifestation of photonics only. Then most importantly, it also applications in defense. It is used in laser range finders, laser guided bombs, target trackers, and simulators of weapon training. These are some of the devices and equipments based on photonics technology. Now, these devices use laser as source along with optical components and electrical instrumentation for the measurement and fire control. So we have just provided you some of the applications of photonics, and this is not an exhaustive list. Other than this also, there are many applications of photonics. We have given you the major ones. So that is all you need to know about photonics. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which mentions that India has attracted highest ever total foreign direct investment inflow during the financial year 2020-21. The total FDI inflow was around $81 billion, and this is 10% higher as compared to the last financial year. In the financial year 2019-20, it was only around $74 billion. As we know, foreign direct investment means the investment through capital instruments, and it is done by a person resident outside India in an unlisted or listed Indian company. So FDI is when a company takes controlling ownership in a business in another country. So through the FDI, foreign companies are directly involved with the day-to-day operations in other country. Now, this FDI is considered as a major source of non-debt financial resource for the economic development, and the FDI flows into India have grown consistently since liberalization. So it is an important component of foreign capital because FDI infuses long-term sustainable capital in the economy. Along with this, there are also other benefits, like it helps in diversifying investors' portfolio. And since it infuses long-term sustainable capital, it also enables the promotion of stable long-term lending. Then it infuses new technology in developing nations. It provides financing to developing countries, that is the receiving country. It also brings the technological know-how and managerial expertise to the receiving country. And by that, it creates more jobs and opportunities. It improves infrastructure, and it also raises the living standards in the emerging economies. And it helps to create competitive global capital allocation. And by all this, FDI facilitates the economic growth or even economic repair. Now, the main financial components of FDI are equity and debt instruments. Equity includes common and preferred shares, reserves, capital contributions, and reinvestment of earnings. And the debt instruments include marketable securities such as bonds, debentures, commercial papers, etc. So just keep these facts in mind. We will discuss these terms in detail some other day. Let us see the news article, which provides us with some important data, which are more important from the prelims perspective. So initially we saw that gross FDI inflows has 10% year on year. This gross FDI inflows include FDI equity reinvested earnings, the equity capital of unincorporated bodies, and other capital. Now, in this FDI equity inflow, it grew by 19% in the financial year 2020-21. Compared to the last financial year, because in this financial year it was around $59 billion, and in the last financial year it was just around $49 billion. And in terms of top investor countries, Singapore is at the apex with almost 29% of FDI. It was followed by USA, which accounted for 23% of FDI, and next comes Mauritius, from where 9% of the capital flows originated. So in short, we can say that FDI equity inflow increased in the financial year 2020-21, and the top investing countries are number 1 Singapore, number 2 USA, and number 3 Mauritius. Now, among the top sectors which received the highest FDI, computer software and hardware is at the top. It accounts for around 44% share of the total FDI equity inflow. Second comes the construction or infrastructure activities, and third one is services sector, which has around 8% of FDI inflow. Now, this data is important because in prelims, you may have a statement like, in the financial year 2020-21, services sector received the highest FDI inflow. But this statement is incorrect because just now we saw that computer software and hardware emerged as the top sector that received around 44% of total FDI equity inflow. Now, among the states which received highest FDI inflows, Gujarat is the top recipient during the financial year 2020-21. It has a share around 37%. It was followed by Maharashtra and Karnataka. Now, here, one more fact we should know, which is that the highest percentage increase in FDI was seen from Saudi Arabia out of the top 10 countries. That means Saudi Arabia is the top investor in terms of percentage increase during the financial year 2020-21. It has the highest percentage because it invested around $2,816 million compared to its previous financial year investment, which was around $89 million. You can see that it has moved from 2-digit investment to 4-digit investment. So that means Saudi Arabia has drastically increased its FDI inflows to India. So here you have to remember this statement, because in prelims there are also statements like this which use the superlatives, like drastically, like that. We saw that inflows from Singapore, USA has also increased, but the drastic increase was seen in the case of Saudi Arabia only. So year-end data like this are important from prelims perspective. So these are some of the points that you need to know about the FDI inflows in the last year. So with this, we have come to the end of news articles discussion session. Now let us move on to the next session of practice questions discussion. In this session, we will see some practice questions based on the news article discussions. Now this first question asks, arrange the following islands from north to south. First one is Minicoy, second Kavaratti, third Agatti, fourth Chetlet. Now you should note that all these islands are islands of Lakshadweep, and generally you should know that Minicoy is situated at the southernmost part of Lakshadweep, as you can see in this map. So it should be at the end because we have to arrange this from north to south. So one should be in the end. From this we can easily eliminate options B and D. Now you have 50% chance of correctly attempting this question. Now other common islands are Kavaratti and Agatti. Now here note that Agatti is to the north of Kavaratti. So that means 2 should be before 1. So our correct answer is option A, 4, 3, 2, 1. As you can see here, this is where Chetlet is, then Agatti, then Kavaratti and Minicoy. Now this next question is based on photonics. It asks, photonics has applications in which of the following? Solid state lighting, cyberknife system, LiDAR, LASIK procedure, barcode scanners. As you know, solid state lighting includes the lighting applications that use LEDs or organic light emitting diodes, that is OLEDs, or even light emitting polymers. These are all commonly referred as solid state lighting. Now in an incandescent or fluorescent lamps, they create light with filaments and gases which are encased in a glass bulb. But in a solid state lighting, it consists of semiconductors that convert electricity into light. And the solid state lighting is used in a variety of lighting applications because it offers many benefits including long life, energy savings and better quality light output, etc. They are also durable, intrinsically safe. So that means first should be an option. So first is an application of photonics. Now the second one is cyberknife system. See, the cyberknife is one of the most advanced forms of radio surgery, and this cyberknife system is a painless, non-invasive treatment that delivers high doses of precisely targeted radiation to destroy the tumors or lesions within the body. It uses a robotic arm to deliver highly focused beams of radiation, as you can see in this picture. So this is also an application of photonics. Now next one is LiDAR. LiDAR stands for light detection and ranging. It is a remote sensing method that uses light in the form of a pulsed laser to measure the ranges to the earth, that is the variable distances to the earth. These light pulses generate precise three-dimensional information about the shape of the earth and its surface characteristics. And this LiDAR instrument principally consists of a laser scanner and a specialized GPS receiver. And this is an example of a LiDAR map. And this LiDAR system allows scientists and mapping professionals to examine both natural and man-made environments with accuracy, precision and flexibility. So LiDAR is also an application of photonics. Now the next one is LASIK procedure. See, LASIK stands for laser assisted in situ keratomyelosis. It is an eye surgery which is best known and most commonly preferred laser refractive surgery to correct vision problems. And it is used as an alternative to glasses or contact lenses. In this LASIK surgery, a special type of cutting laser is used to precisely change the shape of the dome shaped clear tissue at the front of our eye, which is the cornea. This is done to improve the vision. See, in normal eyes, the cornea bends, that is, it refracts the light precisely onto the retina, which is at the back of the eye. But when we have any vision problems like nearsightedness, farsightedness, the light is bent incorrectly, and this results in blurred vision. And this is where we use glasses or contact lenses to correct vision. But in LASIK surgery, the reshaping of cornea is done, which itself also will provide the necessary refraction. And it is used as a correction option to correct the vision problems like nearsightedness, farsightedness and astigmatism. So this is also an application of photonics. And the fifth one is barcode scanners. You would have seen these scanners in the supermarkets at the billing station, which is used to read the price tags. And this is also an application of photonics. So the correct answer is option D, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. All the 5 are applications of photonics. Now this next question is with reference to 81 bonds. The question asks, with reference to 81 bonds recently seen in news, consider the following statements. They are in the nature of perpetual bonds. This statement is correct. During the discussion, we saw that the maturity date is not mentioned in the bond. So it is of perpetual nature. Now, the second statement, if you see, it is contradicting to first statement. It mentions that they are safe investment option carrying minimal risks. See, if the maturity period is not mentioned, then how can it be a safe investment option? So since both the statements are contradicting and statement one is correct, we can say that statement two is incorrect. And here also the question asks for the correct statements only. So the correct answer is option A, one only. Now this next question asks, with reference to 22 degree halo, consider the following statements. They are exclusively a nighttime phenomenon. Now, this statement is incorrect because during discussion, we saw that 22 degree halo is found around sun as well as around moon. That means it appears in nighttime and also in the daytime. And recently, it was observed in the daytime only. Now, the second statement is cirrus clouds are responsible for the formation of these halos. Now, the statement is correct. We saw this during the discussion. And here the question asks for the incorrect statements. So, here also the correct answer is option A, one only. Now, this next question asks, as per the latest estimate released by Ministry of Commerce and Industry, India attracted highest ever total FDI inflow during 2020-21. Which of the following countries is the leading investor in India during financial year 2020-21? Here, the question asks for the leading investor. So, the correct answer is option C, Singapore. We saw that it has a share of around 29%. It is followed by USA and then Mauritius. Now, we saw Saudi Arabia with respect to the percentage increase in investment, because from around $89 million in financial year 2019-20, it has increased its investment to $2,800 million in financial year 2020-21. So here there is a percentage increase, and that is why Saudi Arabia is not the correct answer. Now let us take one mains question based on GS paper 2. This question is based on POCSO Act. We are seeing many references related to POCSO Act in the current affairs. And this question asks us to bring out the gaps which are currently being witnessed in the criminal justice system regarding child sexual abuse. And you have to also critically analyze the POCSO Act. That means you have to mention the positives and negatives in the POCSO Act. You can answer this question in 250 words and you can post it in the comment section for peer review. With this, we have come to the end of today's Hindi News analysis along with the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.